All right, it's officially 9 o'clock. Whoop-de-doo. I'll do the official call sign, okay? Welcome to station WFCK. The only thing missing is you. So there you have it. Here we are, another Thursday night webcast. I gotta get the headphones ready, you know? Because we do have a caller coming in at 9. Let me tell you what's going on as far as the calls tonight. At 9:30 p.m., we have my friend Michael, who, like most of us, is you know, into the science fiction stuff and the geeky stuff and Star Wars, and but we're gonna chat a little bit about Lost in Space, both the original show and the Netflix show. So Michael, let me see if I get his name. It's Panzerotto. Okay, Michael Panzerotto is gonna be joining us at around 9:30. And then at 10 p.m., we have Tanner. You know, Tanner Bot, he's a longtime viewer. He's up in Canada. And Tanner is going to share some of his extreme photography. He like crawls on the top of buildings and then sits on the ledge and takes a pic. I mean, the pics are frighteningly amazing. Don't do this. Like, it's some pretty scary shit. And then at 10:30, and this is tentative, the great Ed Diaz, formerly one of the VPs over at Roland Corporations, he has now launched his own firm, Ed Diaz Keys, as in keyboard keys, and he's at NAMM, not Vietnam, but NAMM is in the music show out in Las Vegas, Lost Wages, and I told Ed that I'm gonna, you know, give a call to his cell phone if he can, he's gonna give us a live update from Las Vegas. Maybe he'll spend a few minutes on the phone with us about that music expo. So, you know, we'll see if we're able to get Ed. But we'll call him. Might call a few other people, too, that are not scheduled and see if they pick up. Nice, can I say. So that's what we got. That's what I got for you. That's what I got for you tonight. What more do you want? That, and you got me, and you got yourselves. And here we are again for another webcast. Okay. So, a couple of things, you know, I was on the way, to the gym, and I listened to a voicemail message from my friend Brian. As you know, I do a fair amount of preparation for these webcasts, both from the technology side and just, you know, setting up the calls and writing some notes so we have a fairly fluid, non-toxic, fluid, you know, event here. And timing was very tight. And I listened to Brian's message. I'm gonna play the message. Let me press buttons and pull up Brian's voicemail message. I will play the audio for this. And I'm just going to do it, you know, iPhone audio. All right. So here's a message.
Al, what's up, bro? Just running around today. I know you're probably working. You're always busy. But I want to let you know I'm researching laptops. So I want to get a, it's time. I need to get a new MacBook Pro, I believe. I'm going to go with probably a 13-inch MacBook Pro. I was just wondering if you had any suggestions. One bigger hard drive, SSD. I know they all come with them now, but just wondering if you had any.
Okay. So Brian is shoplifting a MacBook Pro. And I'm going to have Brian as a scheduled caller. Brian's he's a baller. The guy's a Navy SEAL, a gymnast, family man. He built like a what do you call it? An isolation tank, a sleep suspension isolation tank in the garage. I mean, he's doing some really very, very, very cool stuff. And he does chat with me, with regard to his tech needs. And typically when I'm speaking with Brian, it's a lengthy phone call. All right, so I'm on the way to the gym. I had a training session, and then I wanted to finish up the preparation for this webcast. So I call up Brian, real obnoxious. Brian, you have 60 seconds, okay? Just give it to me again what you're doing. Well, I'm looking at a MacBook Pro 13-inch. No, stop there. No, and Brian is you know, you always have to be respectful to a person's financial situation, but Brian is in pretty good shape. So I said, no, not the 13-inch. Just get the new 16-inch and just load it up with everything. The only decision you have to make is whether you want an FF class 8-terabyte solid-state drive or a 4. I mean, if you got the money to piss away, go with the 8. Put the 64 gigs of RAM in. Get the i9, 8-core, 6-core. What's the highest-end spec besides the dust? Is it 8-core or 6-core? I said, just get it. It's going to whack up to like $5,000 and change, and you'll probably get, you know, 7 to 10 years, 8 years, whatever, out of that laptop. And that's it. And then I hung up and I went and worked out, and now I'm here. So I do want to share that with you. I think the advice is solid. Listen, my nephew bought one. My friend Phil bought one. Everyone, it's like I think one of the best laptops that Apple ever puked out. Is it 8-core? I believe so. Like I said, an 8-core i9, and they got the all that thermal horse shit straightened out so it doesn't throttle down. So that was my advice. I don't know if you agree with me. Well, look who's around. Ron Knights, the main man. Is Ron in the house? Shout out to you, the great Ron Knights. What else I see is freaking Shiggity chatting. And give some other people a chance to chat in there, Gaspar. So anyway, that was my story about Brian. I think I gave him solid advice, and maybe if he gets the thing, because he's, you know, he moves quick. You know, he's hot on this thing. 13 and screw that. Just get the FF class 16 and be done with it. So maybe we'll film an unboxing of his MacBook Pro. It's a beautiful system. It really is. Okay, so I got through a good workout at the gym. Listen, did anyone? Yeah, it's an 8-core whore, I guess. 8-core 16 thread. Nice. Listen, did anyone set any New Year's resolution in motion with regard to their health and wellness and fitness and everything else? For those that ask me about my New Year's resolution, I my answer is 4K. And then you can make the joke, por qué 4K? It's a resolution joke. What's up, Vince Diori in the house? So going back to you, this tremendous viewing audience. God, I love doing this. And I'm so glad you're here, really. But did anyone, you know, make set any goals? I will tell you that when I got back from, I spent 9 days on lovely Long Island and a fair amount of snow and cold. I came back with a cold. So when I'm sick, I don't train. I don't work out. I mean, that's stupid. People that work out when they're sick. No, I say nay, nay, because you get other people sick and your body needs rest. But, you know, I took, you know, 2 weeks off to get rid of this cold. Then we roll into hot. So anyway, my whole workout and diet have been off. But since about December 27th, a few days after Christmas, I mean, you know, I'm back on the diet and exercise regime. So I wanted to ask you, Theron in the house. How are you, Theron? Did anyone set any, you know, New Year's resolutions for your diet and fitness program? And how are you doing? And the reason why I ask, I will tell you this, at LA Fatness, you know, around the corner, I think the New Year's crowd is already starting to die down. The gym is not as packed as I think it should be from all the new signups. So there's the question out to you all. You know, is anyone sticking with it? I mean, we're only, you know, a couple of weeks into the New Year's. I think a lot of people already dropped off. Holy crap. And I bumped into one of my friends at the gym who over the past year has made some tremendous gains. You know it's funny. From what I hear, those that are overweight, obese, it's easier for us who are overweight and obese to lose weight versus the people that are very, 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 very skinny poles, more difficult for them to gain weight and gain muscle. But you know, one of the friends at the gym, his name is Kevin, he put on around 20 pounds of muscle. He's a lean build. And he showed me his before picture. I'm like, holy crap, I didn't even recognize you. And what happened, you know, what got you in that very thin and emaciated state? He said he got run over by a dump truck. This guy got run over by a dump truck. Now, I really wanted to get an elaboration of that story, but you know, he was kind of on his way out. I was on my way in, and I wanted to get my, you know, training done and so I can be ready for you all. So I when I see Kevin again at the gym, I'm going to invite him to see if we can get him as a call-in guest. And I got to hear this. He got run over by a freaking dump truck. Holy crap. Amazing the man's alive. It really is something. But Vince Diori says, "Ugh, my gym is still packed. January's the worst." Darren says, "I noticed there at my LA, not as many people as normally are there this month." Yeah, I'm telling you. People, and shout out to you, Lars. People already dumped out of the New Year's resolution. Amazing. Or like I said, it's the 16th. We're 16 days in. People already said, fuck it. I'll start next month. Yeah, we'll see. So there you go. So that was my gym story. I have been finally unboxing some more gear. You know, I have that tendency to buy stuff and then let it rot in the box for like a million years. And one of my friends, his name is Tony. He's a professional musician. He has a band called Tasty Vibrations. So Tony's been coming by and we've been like, you know, pulling equipment out new in the box. And of course, the whole living room is scattered with gear now. There's a Moog Sub 37 on my desk and the Roland Aria devices are sitting on the couch. But you're going to be hearing more sound. There's going to be more sound equipment bound into this studio setup, so that's going to be kind of fun, and I think I even filmed like a short clip or two. Well, let's see how efficient we're going to go here. Let's see if we can go to the desktop. Hang on a second, folks. Hopefully, I don't click and destroy everything. Let's open up. Where's that damn folder? All right, let's take a look. Fun video clips for today's webcast. All right, let me open up that. And let me see if we can share that clip. I think this is the Roland bass module. All right, so we're gonna go to the desktop, window capture. I think that's it. Image 1354.move. Let's see if it works. I don't think so. A little bit of a fail there, right? Oh, that one. Okay. Yeah, so this is a Roland Aria bass module. You should be seeing that on your screen. So let me play this. Do we have audio?
We have bass. Or if we were fishing, it would be bass. That's a crappy joke.
So that was the Roland bass module that got cranked out of the box. Let's pull up one more clip. This was it's another Roland product. Let's go to that window. Hang on a second. Aria 2. This. There we go. Let's play this.
See, now, Tony, that's really funny because you just said, "Where's the cowbell?" Because you always need more cowbell,
you do,
right?
You do.
That's great. Need more cowbell.
Absolutely.
Press buttons. Nice. Come in.
Yeah, so cowbell is always a good thing. You just, you know, need more cowbell. So stuff's like getting out of the box, you know. I have to fill out like registration cards and crap like that. And, All good. Let's see. Just looking at the chat. Press buttons. Mark Ambrose in the house. I just saw the word monster truck. What's up, Mark? Led Zepp says, "You look good, Al. Haven't seen you in ages. You used to do your shows on Sunday mornings." Right. Okay, yeah. The Sunday morning was for the international crowd. I'm probably going to try to slot that back in. That was like, I did that like, I think 7:30 a.m. for the UK and Europe crew. All good. And you had some surgery or something back then. I had a nasty tumor in my neck. Matter of fact, some of the YouTubers commented on some of the videos, like, what the hell's going on with your neck? I mean, it was big. It was bad. It was a 4.5 hour operation. All good. The scar is nothing. I mean, I healed up really, really well. Matter of fact, I was pretty much up. I was up and out of the hospital within like 20 minutes when they removed the anesthesia, you know, so, quick heal time, all good. Yeah. I'm looking at the chat. Oh, Mike Sullivan in the house. How are you, Mike? Yeah, Theron says you have a bunch of cowbells. Oh, wait. Melon and Hipster says it's 2 a.m. here in the UK. God, you know, watching this webcast, you know, at that time and with your hopes to be a productive adult human being, you know, in the day tomorrow, you know, proper, probably not advisable. I mean, I don't... Whatever. Yeah, right. Guess it's not a tumor. Yeah. The man with the plan said that mic is some serious shit. Yeah, it's a Rode broadcaster mic. Nothing but the best for my viewing audience, you know, and because you get that real that real broadcast, you know, do you have hemorrhoids? You know, you can really kind of dig in. You know, I'll be doing some voiceover work soon, so that will be kind of fun. But what did you say? That Ron Knights taught me computers? Maybe. He's been around a few more years longer than me on this planet, this great planet. So, yeah. So unboxing gear. And when I look at that, at the equipment that I've amassed, there's basically like four discrete studios in the work. We have this, you know, streaming webcasting setup that's going to get some more audio gear. Then I got equipment that kind of creeped into the living room, so that's another studio. The spare room over here is going to be like an analog room. I have a bunch of other Moog gear, including the Moog System 15. And then the real monster is across the street on studio side, the main studio, which is now starting to get wired. So it's all good. Electric Plumber says, is that mic dynamic or condenser? I have no idea. It's a Rode broadcaster. You can maybe Google it real quick and then tell me. I have no idea. But it does sound good. The microphone is running through an Aphex channel strip, which puts in the compression and the noise limiting, and it has a little bit of more robustness to the bass. We like bass, and that's where you got that level of audio. It's real good. You know, some of the viewers told me that I should, and Danielle says hello. Hello, Danielle. Wait a second. Is that you, Will? Led Zepp, you know, identify yourself. A few of the viewers, you know, had requested that I spin off the audio into a podcast. So I have to do some research unless y'all have some suggestions for me for how to, you know, push a podcast out there. I assume it's not brain surgery, for God's sakes. And I have a virtual private server so I can host the crap somewhere. And what? Put it on iTunes and Spotify? I mean, I don't know. That's what my thought. And Miss Darkstar, hi, Laura. How are you? And she does a little research. The Rode broadcaster is a large diaphragm. All right, it's a large diaphragm end address condenser microphone designed to provide the ultimate performance for broadcast vocal applications. Well, there you go. Hey Tanner, I did get the photos and I got you slotted in at 10, and I just got a message from Brian, who I spoke about the laptop. He said, thanks for the great advice. Playing that phone message was funny as hell. I didn't want to interrupt you, thus the personal text. How's that GoFundMe going? Yeah, right. I joke about the GoFundMe for the $53,000 Mac Pro, but I'm not a pig. I can figure it to about $17,500. I should do just fine, you know? So there you go. Good, Brian. I'm glad you're in the house. But Brian, we're going to have to film the unboxing video or even live stream it for this audience. And then we're also going to have you on as a guest caller to talk about your flotation tank and all that other stuff you're doing. So there you go. Brian Williams in the house. And I'm glad he's going to get that FF class laptop, because you need that. I mean, you just need that. I mean, it like blows away all the equipment I have here. It's really quite a machine. And my nephew Mike and my friend Phil, they're really digging it. So there you go. All right. So see, what else are we talking about here? We're talking about the unboxing of the gear and yeah. Oh, you know, this past weekend, a lot of you know her as my vortex of evil, my little vortex, Gabriella. Gabriella is Alex Light's daughter, and she just turned 14. Holy crap. And what was so special about Gabriella, I came over to the house one Halloween. She was like, you know, three, and the older brother was like six or seven, and I came out like full demon makeup. I mean, it was horrific, done by a professional artist. And I'm wearing white contact lenses. Vin opens the door, sees me, and he bolts. Then the three-year-old comes over. She looks at me, kind of turns her head on an angle, and points at me and says, "Can you wear the scary eyes for Christmas?" So after I heard that, I kind of nicknamed her the Vortex of Evil. And she writes horror stories. She loves horror films. She likes that whole genre. And it's really kind of fun. Anyway, the little Vortex turned 14 now. Holy crap. And while Alex Lights and his wife, my cousin Teresa, well, I have to say it properly with that extra R, Teresa, Alex did a really phenomenal dinner presentation, you know, centric to meat. And I did film a short clip. Let me pull up the clip and I will share it with y'all. Hang on a second. I'm pressing buttons right now. Okay. Yeah. Right. How did I title the video clip for this webcast? I titled it "Raw Dead Cow Flesh for Gabriella's Birthday." All right. I'm pulling up the clip and I'm going to share the desktop. And you actually see Rich Jr. from the Dell video, the Dell 8-core horror unboxing video. He's in frame. Let's go to the desktop. Let's capture this window now. Hang on, I'm looking for it. Quick time. Okay, so this is, you know, at Gabber's party. This is just like a little bit of the preparation H. And let me just play the clip and shut up. Here we go. Hang on.
Rich, you video bombing? Teresa, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
For your, is it true that for your daughter's 14th birthday, her request was raw meat? Is it flesh? She wants cow flesh?
Her request was actually Taco Bell for everyone, and I only have two bathrooms. So in exchange for that, we decided to go with raw flesh with raw bacon on top of the raw flesh.
No, it looks beautiful. And master chef of Mr. Alex for your daughter's birthday. Nice. I like that.
So there you go. A little clip I wanted to share with you all. Gabriella, now 14, you know, 14 going on, you know, 27 as it goes. And boy, we had a lot of fun. It was a really nice birthday party. And Vincenzo, him and his buddy Daniel, they got a baby grand piano in the living room, and they did some entertaining. It was really a lot of fun. It was really a lot of fun. And I'm going to have Vin on the show, and I'll play some of his clips too. So there you go. And I'm looking at the chat. Alex Sprague says, "Hey, Alfred, I think I had Pure Evil or my usual username back in the day. Okay, have you on in the background while cleaning for my mother?" Oh, you have me on in the background. "She had a rotator cuff surgery today. Great to see you streaming again." Great, Alex. Now, thank you for joining this group of people. We got 27 people viewing, which is awesome. Because I really only projected 10 or 15, because it's going to take a while to get the momentum fully back. But you know, as I had mentioned in the first webcast 2020 that I did on the 9th, one of the things that stopped me from doing these broadcasts, because as some of the core viewers know, I did over 500 streams. I'll call them webcasts. I streamed about 500 webcasts on Ustream. You know, one of the things that made me wind it down was, of course, was the problem with the necks. It affected my vocals. And the fact that, you know, anyone and everyone can stream anywhere, anytime with their phone, you know, with, you know, Facebook Live and Instagram. And I said, oh, what the hell, you want to, you know. But I, you know, speaking to a lot of you is all about the structure. So yeah, 9 o'clock Eastern, Thursday nights. That's the deal. And I am going to try to do something for the UK crowd and the European crowd to do something Sunday morning, maybe for like an hour, you know, 7:30, 8 a.m., something like that. That would be kind of fun. And Prince Westerberg says, guys, I just watched 1970 and don't need to see any more dead meat. Was it a comedy? That's on the radar with the mighty, mighty Adam B and the whole movie crew where we take up like, you know, a third to a half of the row. So was it good? Prince, did you enjoy that movie? I heard it was very good. It was up for a bunch of awards. So you know, let us know if it's worth our, you know, our money. And sometimes I ask for like a senior discount, but sometimes they don't really buy it. But you know, whatever. Gasper says it was 1917 is a right World War One movie. Yeah. I was joking about it, you know, was it a comedy? So, you know. By the way, because I've been enhancing the technology, and this is a precursor. When I say the word cursor, precursor, like saying, fuck you. No, precursor to the next guest. Hopefully he's able to make it at 9:30. One of my friends, his name is Michael Panzerotto. And we're going to talk about Lost in Space, but let me show you what I dug up from the studio side condo. Okay. How are you, Drew? All right. I'm switching now to something new. All right. So we have the Logitech Brio, sounds like cheese. Okay. That is the primary camera. And then we have the desktop, but now, and I just plugged it in. I really don't like making hardware changes before a live event, but I plugged in the hover cam directly into the USB 3 port. And watch this now. We're going to switch to the hover cam. Click, click, crick, crick. So there you go. Look at this. Look at this. This is my lunchbox. My Lost in Space lunchbox from 1967. I mean, you know, I was going into first grade with that sucker. So there you go. Let me know if you can see it and if the clarity is just groovy. But yeah, that's some vintage stuff. So that indeed is the setup for the Lost in Space discussion with Mr. Michael Panzerotto. Hopefully I'm pronouncing his name correct. But yeah, let's flip it so you can see the other side. So there you go. They have the spaceship, just so awesome. The Jupiter 2 and the robot and you know, a little bit of laser action there. Yeah, it's in pretty good condition. It's in pretty good condition. And this hover cam is great because now I can project down to an item on the desktop. All right, so that's kind of fun. But hang on one second, I want to get something. So yeah, so Lost in Space. I am going to send a text shortly to Michael to see if he is available, and then I'm going to give him a call. So back to my mug. There we go. Yeah, so hover cam, a really pretty cool device, and it gives us a clean video feed with something on the desktop. So that's now integrated. And I did get another Logitech 4K Brio camera. I got another one to give you a different angle because I'm going to hook up probably some more audio gear here so you can see and hear all that crap. And I got to get that vocoder back over so I can do the, you know, welcome to alpha.tv type of thing we do. Anyway, let me send a text to Michael. Nothing like that Razer keyboard, right? With all the colored lights, and it's loud as hell. When my niece Alexa was down a few years ago, I mean, Sunday morning, they're trying to sleep, and I'm like doing work. I'm banging on this freaking keyboard and just pretty annoying. And Drew says, I'm clicking in your face. Thanks, Drew. Other great Mo. Mo, I need, you know, we had the condo elections tonight, and I really wanted to go and try to help out, but I had to do, like I said, some prep for this, and I wanted to keep the continuity since we had such a good launch, you know, the prior Thursday. But Mo is in the condo. He's up a couple of floors, and he joins me at the NatMac meeting, the National Macintosh User Group meeting that's run by the mighty Adam B and Scott and Dean. We have a lot of fun. We sit in the back making jokes. But Mo is a MacBook Pro owner. Not the newest 16-inch, but I think it's on his radar, though. You know, it's all good. But yeah, so I have a message out to Michael to see if he's available. No, we need a MIDI guitar, absolutely. Okay, Michael says he's indeed ready. So I'm going to give him a shout, and we're going to talk a little bit nerdy stuff about Lost in Space. Oh boy, strap in for this one. Or strap on, whatever you want. It's all good. All right, I'm clicking. There's my address book. Okay, let's see. Can I like cut and paste the phone number into Skype? That would be nice. Let's see. Search Skype. Paste. Okay. Oh, how you like that? Call number. All right. Let me just wait. Michael is replying to my text. Let me just get his response. Either that or he hit the space bar and I'm just getting the three dots. You ever do that? You ever send someone like on an iPhone that GIF image of like the three dots as if you're typing? Okay, he says, Willie enables Sire. Excellent. All right, we're going to give him a call. Hang on a second, everyone. I'm still pressing buttons. Pardon me a second. I just want to widen up the window. And I need to get the mixing console on the desktop so we can adjust the volume so you can hear Michael in all his glory. All right, we're calling the number now.
Hello?
Michael, how are you? Can you hear me?
Can you hear me?
Yes, I'm just going to boost your gain just a little bit. Give me a 1, 2, 3, check, check.
1, 2, 3, check, check.
Okay, I think you should be loud and clear in the chat room. I don't know if you were watching, but I just showed the viewers my Lost in Space lunchbox from 1967.
Is it the real thing or is it a reproduction?
Oh no, it's my lunchbox from first grade. I have
that's yours.
Yes, yeah.
Oh, that's really cool.
Yeah,
that's really cool.
I have a tendency not to throw stuff out. I think it's a genetic disorder. My sister suffers with the same problem. My brother suffers with the same problem, and my cousin Madeline suffers with the same problem. I mean, it's really something. Yeah, it's really something.
Well, the Italians are that way.
I figured you were a good Jewish boy with the name Panzerotto. No, I mean, but
right,
it could be an Italian thing. I think you're absolutely right.
So in my house we have probably 40% of the furniture was either this aunt or this uncle or this grandmother. You can't get rid of it because sin.
Right.
You know, that kind of thing. So you collect it, and I have I'm very attached to a lot of my stuff. Now, as far as Lost in Space stuff, I was born in 74, so I was aware of it in rerun.
Right.
When I was about five and fell in love with it. So the toys weren't around. And I can remember my father had a brother who was only 15 when I was born, so he was old enough to still have a lot of stuff. And I remember getting on him for not saving me his robot.
Well,
so listen, I didn't get one until I was about 8.
Well, you know, with some of those old toys, you know, I look at the things that I exploded with M80s back in the day. Okay. And I had a series of toy called Major Matt Mason, which was incredible. They had an incredible space station and jetpacks, and it was a Mattel product, and they go for some pretty good numbers on eBay. And what else did I blow up? The G.I. Joe Gemini space capsule, which was fabulous with the doll. You know, these things, you know, they were blown up in M80s, a lot of shrapnel or gasoline and melted and whatnot.
Oh, yeah.
And of course, you know, people, oh my God, that thing is worth. And when they tell me how much it's worth, I tell them, look, if you didn't have people like me blowing this stuff up and burning it and doing whatever, smashing it, then you wouldn't have the few that are worth so much money.
Well, you know, that Matt Mason station is the precursor. I think it was the precursor of the design for this, the Death Star toy when I was a kid, because if you look at them, they look very, very similar. Three levels.
Okay.
You know, the guys that play, they're very similar. So, but I agree with you. I had friends who, I mean, they were Star Wars nuts, and I liked Star Wars, but I loved Lost in Space. And, their toys were barely touched, and they were like 9-10 years old, and they would have these toys and nobody would play with them. They were very particular with them.
Did they keep them in the box? OCD just in the box?
No. Like, well, my one friend, my one buddy, his name was Eddie. He wouldn't let you play with his toys. He had them out, but nobody could touch him. My buddy Randy took very good care of his, but he did play with them.
Right.
And mine were a wreck.
Oh,
the arms were loose. You know, I was constantly dropping them out of windows.
You enjoyed them. No, it's okay. One of my friends from Long Island. He actually kept all the toys like new in the box. You know, like he wasn't buying toys. And this is as he told me as when he was even younger, he was getting toys as gifts or buying them. But he was in a collection mode. In other words, he looked at that toy as a future collectible. I really have to circle back with him and see. You know, I'm sure he has some things that are really valuable. I mean, you know, people. It's a big thing now with the with the retro stuff.
Commodities, man.
But
my grandfather was, you know, came over here with my coal mines when he was 11, and I used to be maybe 10 years old playing with my toys. He said, "You still are playing with toys?"
Yes. Well, listen, and now that we're adults, we play with them again. I will tell you and the viewers that I do have a built Lost in Space model. That was like a pre-built ship. It was pretty cool. I have a tall Lost in Space robot that's remote controlled. It's pretty big. I got it as a housewarming gift when I bought my condo like 27 years ago. It was pretty expensive too. A friend got it for me. I should have really brought that out for the show. Maybe next time. And then I have the pod, which is really cool. You know, I forgot which company had released it, but it was like, I don't know, maybe 8 or 10 years ago. It's beautiful.
Polar light.
Yeah, probably was that. But Mike, let me ask you, because I've seen, you know, I connected with Michael on Facebook because we were in the Netflix Lost in Space group, correct? Or was it the traditional one?
Yeah.
Right.
I think the Netflix.
It was the Netflix one, and you had put up some video clips of you doing vocalizations like the original Dr. Smith, and so I ask. I mean, I'm going to make an assumption. I assume you also are a professional actor, correct?
Yeah, I am indeed. Mm-hmm. Because of Lost in Space.
Is that what got you into
Shadows.
It?
Those are the two.
Is that what got you into acting?
Yeah. As a kid, you know, we would go out, you would watch the show. This was the tradition. We went to school, we came home, the shows were on, it was the summertime and we would stop playing and the shows would come on and we would go back out. And I was always finding myself orchestrating the play, the routine into what I just watched. And then I realized as I got older, you know, hey man, I'm still trying to do that. I used to start making movies with a video camera. Get into acting. You know, that's what you want to do, is to play these these characters. Dr. Smith, Jonathan Harris, Bill Mooney. I mean, those guys did some wild things on that show, and they really made you care about the characters.
Yes, yeah, they sure
and
did.
And then Dark Shadows was the same. Watching Jonathan Frid as the vampire. I mean, the guy played. I mean, watching Dark Shadows was like watching a live, like a stage play. When you watch Dark, because it was shot live or recorded live, they didn't go back and erase era. So, you know, you watch this, you get a really deep set taste for theater, as well as the old horror films, I have to say. Vincent Price, Peter Cushing, and Karloff. Those were three other big influences on me. Because I could, and it's funny, all of these people that I really like, exception possibly of Billy Mooney, were classically trained actors. Well, only in my family, nobody knew how to articulate that. We just said different. My mother used to always say, everybody you like is different.
It's something I had seen of Jonathan Frid, who is from Dark Shadows. And that's like, yeah. I remember when seeing that, you know, in its original run, right? He was like around mid-60s, correct?
Yeah, the same time as Lost in Space.
Right.
I think Dark Shadows lasted two more years.
Okay, so I was like, whatever, 7 or 8. I was like, I used to scare the shit out of me. And I saw a mm-hmm. YouTube video that Jonathan Frid had put up, and he did a whole segment on is the word elocution in how you pronounce.
Oh yeah.
So can you talk a little mm-hmm. bit about that?
I know
that?
Exactly, at a convention.
Yeah, that was the clip.
He was at a Dark Shadows convention.
Yeah, can you share a little bit about elocution and how important that is in acting and in just basic communication, also how we kind of bastardize it now?
Yeah, sure. Well, it's not only how you pronounce things, diction, and how you articulate things, but it's the noise that you can make. It's using the voice as a tool. The thing is, it's very interesting because we all have the benefit of film. We can witness the death of elocution. And so you've got the guys like Jonathan Frid, Jonathan Harris, Peter Cushing. Well, that's because he's English, so it's kind of natural to them. But Vincent Price, Clifton Webb, when you listen to them speak, or even many of the older actors, Joan Bennett, they articulate their words perfectly. Each word is pronounced. They use the whole mouth.
Right.
When they speak, their diction, sometimes a lot of Fraser Crane would be the closest thing you can come to Kelsey Grammer, to something of that nature in the United States now as an American.
How about
as an American actor?
How about the actor, you know, now his name escapes me, that played Captain Picard? He had outstanding elocution as well.
Oh, well, Sir Patrick Stewart, well, he was from the Royal Shakespeare Company. So, yes, he did. And he was my other, as a teenager, he was huge. He meant a lot to me, Patrick Stewart, because he was not only did he speak beautifully and carry himself beautifully, but women liked him. So that gave me hope, because all the other guys were either blowing the women up or, you know, people. So I thought, you know, if this is the kind of actor, I'll never get a girlfriend. But then when I saw Patrick Stewart, I saw it. But anyway, for the most part, it was a very big thing. And the studios used to groom you that way. In the old studio days, they would teach their actors how to speak, how to walk, how to move. They were fabricated completely.
Right.
And they were told you had to speak to be a theater. It kind of comes naturally because you're speaking to an audience away from you, and you've got to be clear and pronounced. But there's a word for it. I can't remember what it is. Something Pacific Standard English or something that they use where it's American English, but they all almost sound English. And that went away with Marlon Brando and James Dean.
Interesting.
When they came on the scene and they started talking like people talk. And to a lesser degree in England, Olivier. Because Olivier spoke beautifully, but he spoke English as you would hear the average person speak. So if you watch Olivier and Othello or Olivier and Hamlet, and you were to hear John Gielgud play the same part, they would be very distinct differences in the way they speak. So when Brando came on, all of those older actors started to die off, or they started getting less parts. So the smart ones, like Karloff and Vincent Price found horror films, because they could take that stage training and that kind of big acting and do it in a way that would be palatable to people.
And it made their part and presence on film bigger as well, with that type of vocalization and pronunciation and whatnot.
Jonathan Harris, there's an interview with him where they said to him, Mr. Harris, what advice do you give to a young actor? And he said, be a dentist, be an accountant. They always say to me, Mr. Harris, how do you do it? It's such a nasty business. And he says, they're concerned with the size of a Winnebago. He said, they can't even talk. And I can't stand it. It turns my stomach. And Vincent Price is on Larry King Live saying the same thing. When they came on, it was, and you can't even understand them. But that's the way they, quote unquote, people speak. So it took on. I prefer a more elocution, more pronounced diction, kind of, and it may not be real, but that's what I enjoy.
All right, here's the question, Michael. When you're disciplining your children, do you amp up the voice using all your training?
I have a few times. It's funny because. That's so funny. If I'm getting on my kids, I go into what I call Gandalf mode. So if you watch the Lord of the Rings, there's portions of those films when Gandalf gets upset and he seems to grow taller and his voice gets more pronounced and echoes in the room shadows.
Right, right.
So I try to mimic something like that so that they get a sense of, and I do it with my dogs even, and the word that I use is enough. So I'm going to try this. Enough! But I do a little harder, and it gets a little. The dogs all freeze, so it's a lot of fun. But yeah, you do. I use it. My day job is phone. A lot of phone work,
right?
And you use it there. I do readings, a lot of readings, and that's where elocution becomes really important. The use of language. If you listen to, if you ever get time, get on, listen to Karloff.
Okay.
And Price, their scary stories on YouTube. It's really fun because you hear them, like the word push and pull. There's a verb. Something is happening. You can't just say, pushed and pulled. You have to use it for what it is. Push, pull. You know, you want to feel, if you're reading or on stage, in fact, you want to feel that. You want to convey the feeling of those words to the audience. In film, you don't have to because the camera is right in front of you.
Right.
So you want to pull in, but on stage you push out, and that's where elocution becomes really important. Fritz was a classically trained actor as well.
Right. That would make sense.
In Canada.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. His vocalizations were amazing. So, let's go back onto Lost in Space, and thank you for sharing. That information about elocution and you know what you've learned in your career as an actor. By the way, do you do Renaissance Festival stuff? Do you ever do that if it's in your area?
There's a big one in the Maryland area, and I never worked it. I have friends and colleagues who do it. There's a Shakespeare. It's funny because there's a Shakespearean festival. In the area that I've been thinking about, and we've got a lovely, it's called the Chesapeake Shakespeare Company down here, and I just contacted somebody and I said, he's in it, and I worked with him in another show recently, and I said, would you mind meeting with me, and I'll buy you drinks and dinner or whatever, but to teach me a little bit about what to do when you try out for Shakespeare, because I've only done modern pieces or things like Dracula,
right.
Nothing Shakespearean, and that's really my goal. That's almost like a hat dream to me, is to do Shakespeare. To me, when I was a kid, I thought if you had either a sir in front of your name, like Sir John Gielgud or Sir Laurence Olivier, that was meant you were serious. But if you were a Shakespearean actor, look out. That meant you could do all the cool roles. So that stuck with me. So that's my goal, to get involved with
see,
that.
See, if I had the prop with me, I'd be shaking a can of beer saying, look, I'm doing Shakespeare. Shakespeare. That's as good a bad joke I could do on quick notice. Terrible. You would probably have a ball, though, doing the Renaissance. So I love interacting with the Renaissance people. We have a couple of fairs down here in South Florida. One's coming up in February, so I will be going. You know, unfortunately, I don't have the clip at hand. One of the characters, a woman in character, she'd go around as Tess, first name Tess, last name Tickle. So she was Tess Tickle, you know, and she was a big hit at the show. And what did I say? I did come back with something semi-witty when I spoke to her. Let me see. Yeah, right. So she introduced herself as Tess Tickle, and I said, I'm Dick Hertz. Richard Hertz. And
fell of the ball.
Yeah, and I guess there's an area in New Jersey, I think, called Holden, New Jersey, and he says, "Oh, you're Dick Hertz from Holden." Which was, I mean, that was really brilliant. All right, so Michael,
she's a witty wench.
Say again.
She's a witty wench.
Yeah, no, she was wench Tess Tickle, and she was really really funny, and she did that fair in South Florida for a long time. But getting back on Lost in Space, we spoke a little bit about the 60s show, and obviously we don't want to reveal any spoilers. But the Netflix reincarnation, they dropped season two on Christmas Eve or whatever, and I really enjoy. I mean, it's filmed beautifully. The soundtrack is on point. I really liked what they did with the characters, and you know, what's your take on it? I mean, did you enjoy? How many days did it take you to watch the whole second season, Michael?
I watched it. I love it. It took me a little while because my son, I have two. I have an 18-year-old and a 10-year-old, and the 18-year-old is off doing 18-year-old things. But we wanted to watch it together, so we watched a little of it, and then he did his thing, and then we came back and we wrapped it up. But Christmas Day, we watched a good bit of. And I think I agree with you. It's you know, a lot of people get bent out of shape about it, and I get it in the sense that, you know, you're loyal to the old show and all of that. But look, I mean, Dyer Williams and Jonathan are gone. June's in her 90s.
Yeah.
Dick Tufeld and Bobby May are gone. You can't. We can't get it back. I mean, you can't. You know. It's time for my kid, and this is exactly what I tell fans. I want my son to be as excited over our Lost in Space as I was, and, you know, let this robot really rock him, you know. So I think it's great. I think Parker Posey, she's almost like a Hannibal. If Dr. Smith were Hannibal Lecter, she's almost like that kind of eerie kind of creepy in the first season.
She's psychotic. She's effing nuts. And Adrian in the house. Good to see you, Adrian. She's psychotic. But listen, for the viewers, if you're not familiar with it, you know, check out, you know, the Netflix series Lost in Space. It's two seasons. The first season has pretty good momentum. There are some parts that have like a two or three episode story arcs. There's a little bit of dips as they're developing the characters. Season two, and correct me if I'm wrong, Michael, season two is pretty much very compact, standalone. We're in a bad situation. Let's get it resolved. They kind of MacGyver it. And listen, everyone has ADD in the year 2020. So I guess they got some feedback from those two or three episode story arcs, and they really amped it up. But I mean, the filming and the soundtrack and the cinematography, it's great. And you know what? You know, for those that have young children, I mean, this is something that a whole family can watch. You know, they pulled it off.
Oh yeah,
it really good. And Michael, just so you know, I'm going to be very upfront. I'm very transparent with this viewing audience. I mean, the main reason why I slotted this in for the show tonight is maybe we'll get some of the viewers of this show watching it, which will make the Netflix numbers go up, so they renew it for season three. So yeah, there was an ulterior motive on why I'm doing this for me and Mike. Should we get season three?
I really hope there's a season three, because there are questions I want answered.
Yes.
I think they're killing me here. They're killing me.
And Scott in the chat room, Scott in the chat room says it's a worthy successor. You know, yes.
And I want Kevin Burns to put me in it.
And by the way, we have some international viewers here. Prince Westerberg is chiming in 2:47 a.m. Melon and Hipster 2 a.m. Gout Glass Cow here. So God bless you all over across the pond watching this at the wee hours of the morning. Like I said, this type of webcast can cause some form of brain damage. You're not going to be a functional adult tomorrow. Hopefully you don't have to go to work or whatever. You work at home.
Right.
Michael, this was very enjoyable. I got to get ready for the next caller. But I wanted to thank you really sincerely for coming in and sharing some of what you do in your field of acting and some of your comments on Lost in Space. And we're going to have you back. We'll have to have you back again and continue this, because I think a lot of people would want to hear more about what you do on the acting end of things. The next caller I have, his name is Tanner. He's up in Canada, and Tanner, he kind of works his way, I'm not going to say legally or illegally, but he gets to the top of buildings in Canada, very 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 tall, like skyscrapers, and hangs over the edge and takes pictures. You know, don't do this at home, kids. But so he's queued up next. But Michael, thank you again, and enjoy.
No, it was my pleasure.
Yeah, enjoy the rest of your evening, and
buona fortuna.
We'll talk to you again. All right.
Take care now.
Thank you, Michael. Take care. Bye bye. And there you have the great Michael Panzerotto. Very interesting about the whole elocution and speech and diction and whatnot. And Adrian, you're in the chat room. You're packing for a business trip. Adrian, we have to schedule you. Adrian Kid Guru, one of the early internet entrepreneurs. Total baller, this guy. We got to get caught up on what you're doing. From what I see on your Instagram posts, you seem to be doing quite well, and you look great, Adrian. Keep up the good momentum. Good for you. Good for you. Drew says, only got 4 short hours tomorrow, thank God. Oh, of work? And Kyle says, working on finding an original iPhone to screw around with. I think I got one of them. It doesn't work. Do I have one? Let me see. Hang on. Original iPhone. Where is that piece of shit? Yeah, here it is. All right, listen. We're gonna switch over to Hovercam. So, this is so good. Here you go. Well, I think that should do it. All right, hang on, folks. This is multimedia, and a shout out to Multimedia Jay, a great inspiration for all the crap I do. All right, let's see if we can switch this to the Hovercam. New toy. There you go, folks. Original iPhone. Yeah, I got this from my friend Larry. I think it was his. And I don't have the password or whatever. It's long gone. I don't even know if it powers up. But it's kind of cool to have this first-gen phone, you know, kicking around. So there you go. And we have live action from that Hovercam. Whoop-de-doo. And since I have the Hovercam up, let me show you something else. This is great. Hang on. I'm going to show you a Christmas card. Okay. I'm showing you got a Christmas card here. Now, the Christmas card came via my friend and his daughter and son. His son's 9 and the daughter is 7. And they wanted to give me a Christmas gift. Okay. And very nice. They gave me a beautiful band for my Apple Watch. But what was great, just they wrote ho 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 on the card. Look at how she spelled ho. She spelled ho H-O-E, and I really had to hold myself back from cracking up. I didn't want to make a vulgar joke in front of the kids. But is that great or what? Come on. That is like gold. I mean, and it was really funny because I said, Uncle Alfred, open the card first. I'm like, sure. And I'm seeing ho, ho, ho. And what was the punchline? You know, what did Santa Claus when he saw what did Santa Claus say when he saw the three hookers? He said ho ho ho. So there you go. And Gasper says, laughing my ass off for a split second, I thought it said Dick the Halls. No, Gasper, it didn't say Dick the Halls. Deck. Yeah, so the fact that you put the H-O-E, good stuff. Good stuff. But yeah, there you go. What's up, Aaron? yeah. Now, you know, some of you have asked about, you know, the iPhone whore 4S that I never opened. I never opened it. The iPhone 4S. It's still new in the box. And at this point, I'm going to bundle it with Steve Jobs' business card from 1980 and put it on eBay for $100,000. I mean, if someone wants it, knock yourself out. There is an auction house that I initiated dialogue. I have not followed up with them. They want the card. They're very interested in the Steve Jobs business card. But I think it might be fun to just put it up on eBay for some ridiculous amount and just get the PR from it, you know? So there we go. All right, let's see. Let's see if we can get Tanner. I need to give you the phone number for Skype. You don't have to use Skype. It's just like I bought a phone number. So you think I remember my own number? I say nay, nay. So let me pull up my contacts. I mean, not the ones in my eye, but like, you know, let me contacts. And I have to type in like search for me. And that's not working. All right, hang on a second, folks. A little bit of a technical delay. Tanner, I assume you're in the room. You know, insult me so I know that you're here. Call me old. You like doing that routine. It's good. Where did I put my contacts book? Is that it? No, that's not it. Notebooks. Wow. Hang on a second. I must have hid the window. All right, there it is. Contacts. This is a total tech fail. It's pretty embarrassing. It's only showing me one person. Where's the window? Bring all to front. No, all right. This is so stupid. It's showing me Gus Fink. He was a caller from a while back. Wow, this stupid view. Hide groups. Last import. Go to the next window. Zoom. The window's gone. All right, this is, yeah. Does anyone know my phone number? This is really bad. Sorry. Hello? Wait a second. Oh, all right. Wait, the window just popped up. All right, we're good now. All right, hang on. Okay. All right, Tanner, here's the Skype number. You ready? I'm gonna verbalize it. 95-whore. 7-1-9. I'm old. 6-1-5-whore. All right, you got it? Don't make me repeat it. 95-whore. 7-1-9. I say Juan because we're in South Florida. 6-1-5-4. So freaking call a number. Hope you're laughing at this shit. I sure am. It's all good. Right. Tanner, are you here? Yeah. Tanner gives, dial 1-800-666-6969. That's 1-800-666-6969. What is that number, Tanner?
Is that your sex line? Hi there. Welcome to, yeah, whatever.
What'd you say, Gasper? You can paste it? At first I thought you wrote you wear pasties. Prince says you put it in the last live stream, so I had to take a screen grab. There you go. Tana, no, I said it. He should have it. I'll copy and paste it. Yeah, we'll do it that way too. Yeah, we I'd say, you know, having the Skype number, I mean, it costs me money, but it makes it much more convenient because people don't have to use Skype. They just call it their freaking phone. They're, you know. That turn you on, Gasper? Nice. Kyle says, I miss when Skype was a single column friends list with the conversations in separate windows. Yeah, no, Kyle, I don't like the interface change that they've done to Skype. You know, let me see, is Skype up? I think I might have just accidentally closed it. All right, Skype is back online. All right, so go ahead, Tanner. All right, he said, 1 second. So there you have it. While Tanner is getting himself in order for this wonderful phone call, I really should get his photographs pulled up because that would make sense so you can see the pictures when he calls in, right? So let's do that. I'm just pressing buttons right now, so bear with me. So, all right, Tanner's label the folder Tanner's Extreme Photography, which makes sense. And let's pull up the first one in this mix. I mean, these photos they're beautiful. He did such a phenomenal job with the pictures. There really are some. Let me just open all of them, and then we'll cycle through them. All right. Tanner, I assume that's you. Hang on a second.
Yeah, that would be me.
I don't have the headset nearby. I'm just opening up your photos and let's see if we have audio. Tanner, give me a 1, 2, 3 test.
1, 2, 3 test.
Yeah, it works. They should be hearing you loud and clear. How you doing, Tanner?
I'm all right. I just got to work. I'm gonna be starting work soon because I work overnights.
Oh, you just got to work?
Yeah, well, I made time, so, like, I came earlier to work, so I have some time to do this kind of thing.
Oh, excellent. Excellent. All right. So, yeah. So you know, the background, you really got into some really phenomenal and very unique photography that I see you post on your MySpace, your Facebook page.
Yeah,
I'm looking. Yeah,
I don't post as frequently there. It's more on Instagram, but Instagram has kind of became more of an area where I do like what I call loosely boudoir-y stuff.
Okay.
So I wouldn't show any of that kind of stuff on screen.
Right.
But what I sent you is I still do that. I still do rooftops. I still do street stuff. I still do any kind of urban-y kind
right,
of stuff.
Urban-y. So I'm going to the one. Where you're on like some crossbeam, the needle is in the background. Let's go to the desktop. Hang on a second, folks. You got to see this photo. I mean, it's just mind blowing. It just absolutely mind blowing. 7, 6, 8. All right, let me pull up this photo. Hang on 1 second. Hang on, Tanner. I got to look at. My contact lenses are like tuned up for distance. All right, 6, 7, 0, 8. Where the hell is that? Six. All right, here. I mean, all right. That picture is now showing where you're on that beam. I mean, come on, audience, look at this. This is like incredible. This photo is incredible.
Is it the one where it's? Is it somebody that's sitting like on the edge of a building?
Yes.
On the stream, like I have the stream muted, but what I see on the stream is like, I guess like the video that you were showing previously.
Yeah, there's a little bit of a delay, so you'll see the picture pop up. Oh. But you're on a beam.
Yeah. Okay. So so that's my friend, one of the guys that I usually go on rooftops with.
Okay.
That building's called 10 York. I actually got caught there. Last winter around the same time, and you do, at least in Canada, you do get charges, but it's nothing as severe like as in the States. You can actually go to jail in the States, whereas in Canada it's more of a less severe offense. I only got $65 and it doesn't even really show up on your record.
Now let me ask you something. When your friend got off that structure, Like, did he like belly flop and crawl? I mean, that's the way I would do it. I mean, or did he just walk off of it?
Yeah, no, yeah, you just walk off of it. Like, there's like a part of it where you just, like, if you're afraid of heights, you just hold on to like the side of the building, and you're pretty good, honestly. Like, you have to have a lot of self-confidence in yourself in order to do this kind of stuff. Because if you don't, you will actually fall. But like, I mean, people do die actually from this. So I would highly recommend to anybody watching this during the stream or after the fact that they do not do this. I don't condone that anybody does this actually, because you are putting yourself at risk. I've been on over 300 buildings. I haven't fell once, but that's not to say, you know, it could happen one day, right?
I mean, I really can't use that. Listen, usually when I'm doing or filming something stupid, the usual punchline I say is, kids, don't do this at home. Do it at your friend's house. But that doesn't work for this. Like, it's not like you can do it at your friend's house. But but I tell you, I'm getting like anxiety just looking at the photograph. But it really is just it's mind blowing. What was the equipment you used to capture this image?
I use a Sony A7 III on a 14mm Rokinon f/2.8 lens. I usually have to have it bumped up to f/5 before it's actually decently sharp, because the center of the image is more sharper than the outer parts. So I usually put it at around f/5. Even if it's like during the day, I still put it at f/5.
So this is a Sony, I assume, what, the mirrorless camera? Sony mirrorless camera?
Yeah, exactly.
The A7?
It's the lowest form of a Sony camera, but it's a full frame body.
Yeah, it is beautiful. It is beautiful, yeah. And obviously this is, you know, just one click. In other words, it's not like iPhone, which taking 9 pictures and merging it. This is one.
Yeah, this is. I think this was a 1 second long exposure.
On a tripod.
Yeah, exactly. It was on a tripod.
And did you take it through a window, or where the hell were you standing?
I was, so like, if you look at the part where like there's the triangle and then it comes to like one little piece, sorry.
Yeah.
I was right there. Like, so like I'm not on the edge, but I'm sort of near the edge. I've been on this building 5 or 6 times now. So like I have no problems with this building.
So when you're hanging out with friends and say, yeah, I'm going to go get high, I mean, this is what you mean, I guess, right?
Yeah, exactly. This is exactly what I mean. You do get a high because you get an adrenaline high.
Well, how many stories up are you?
This one, 10 York, is with the mechanical room. This one's about probably, I think, 80 almost.
Because it looks like you're towering over the other skyscrapers that are out there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, he is. Like, there's, like, the one with, like, those, like, as you would call it, like, cheese graters. That's what everybody just calls it, because that's what it is. That one, it's hovering above that one, and then there's one called, those two are called, because there's two of them that have the circles on the top. It's called ice condos.
Right.
The other one is taller than this one, though.
Gotcha. Okay. All right, well, listen, that's 80 stories up. That's pretty damn impressive. Glad you and your colleagues are safe. And yeah, gang, don't do this. This is some pretty extreme no. stuff. Let's I know you sent me a few other photos. Let me pull up. Let's see what else we got here. Hang on a second, Tanner. And like I said, there's about a 20 second delay. All right, so that was, let's look at this one, 1385. This is, wow, what a beautiful. Let me just pull it up. Hang on a second, Tanner. Actually, it should be.
Let me know, like, kind of like a description of what you see, just so I know which one you're looking, because I haven't pulled up too. Like, in the email that I sent you, I haven't pulled up. So.
Okay, so what we got here, yeah, I'm just minimizing the other ones. Wow, this one's a great shot. These shots are just, your photography is really brilliant. Okay, this is like the needle, and it looks like it's a laser blasting into a girder.
Okay, so and it's got like a group of a bunch of people.
Yeah,
okay,
five of your colleagues.
The thing above this, which is called the CN Tower, that's called a window cleaning arm, or like a BMU. Yeah, BMU. It's just like a fancy word for like a window cleaning arm.
Right. And are these other people in the picture, these like your buddies that your group that you do this with?
Yeah, the three on the right side of the image are the ones that I usually shoot with. The other two, I don't shoot with anymore just because they don't do roofs anymore, really, or they don't really do roofs at all, really.
Right.
So, but the other three guys on the right side of the image, yeah, I'm usually with them, as we call them, like, that's my crew.
Gotcha. Now, listen, obviously we're seeing photographs where there was, you know, success, you know, getting to your destination. Tell us some of the stories where you made the attempt, but you didn't get up there. Like, you know, the security guy caught us coming up this backside, you know.
Security never ever catches me going up. The only time, like, security will stop me, because these are most of the places that I've done. I've ventured out into doing businesses like banks, or like big business banks and all this stuff. Those ones are a bit harder because obviously you're going through doors that you're not supposed to be, and I won't say on which ways I'm going through because
that isn't
how I roll in terms of giving people information, because they might want to try this themselves, and then I don't need to hear on the news that anybody died. So usually the only time I get stopped, though, long story short, is usually when I go into places, they kind of generally already know, the security knows everybody that lives in that building because they see them every day. So that's the only time I get stopped. The other time is if they come on the roof and they say, hey, what are you doing here? And then you either run from security and you just kindly just tell them, hey, we're just here for photos. You can see we haven't done anything to your building. They might start yelling at you sometimes to just try and make you scared and try and say, oh, you're going to go to jail for this. But most times I've been on 300 different roofs multiple different times. So probably been on at least 400 or 500 different roofs or combined, sorry. And I've only been caught 6 times. So that's a pretty good percentage. And like I say, security is the only time at the front desk is when they stop me.
Gotcha. All right, let's look at another pick. Let's see what we got. Let's go to the next one. Window capture. Let's go to... Hang on one second.
And I am editing these in Lightroom, and then sometimes I put them in Photoshop.
Gotcha. 261. All right, let's see if I can pull up this one. I minimize some of these into the dock, so I think I confuse it. Let me just switch back to my face, and then I'm going to go back to the desktop. Hang on a second, Tanner. Do that. Hello, I am here. And let's go back to the desktop and Windows capture, and let's see what we got. Okay, this one. Your feet are just dangling, and the camera angle is down. You're wearing ripped jeans like I like to wear, and wow, what a shot. Holy cow. Incredible picture. This is incredible. What a shot.
Is it on the corner, or is it
you're on the
facing another
building? You're on the very, very extreme corner. You are on the sitting on the outside of this building. Holy shit. Just off the wall. This picture is amazing.
Are the shoes white and orange and black?
Their shoes
just the delay. It's just the delay. That's why. That one I've been on, I want to say probably like 10 times now. It is what it is, right? Like the thing is with that image, it was vertically flipped because it looked better to me this way as opposed to the other way that it was taken, which was my feet were on the bottom of the image as opposed to the top.
Right. No, this picture is breathtaking. I have to assume that you can license some of these photos out to whomever. I mean, they're really amazing. You know. You could do the inspirational quote. You know, reach new heights. You know, whatever.
It's exactly what it is.
Because like I said,
anybody that is into this stuff. I mean, if somebody's in your city, you could. I wouldn't suggest reaching out to them, but there is people all around the world doing this. Like, I'm not, you hear it about all the time on the news that like somebody dies, or you hear about somebody on, or you see somebody on the news on these rooftops, or even climbing cranes too nowadays.
You don't classify this as parkour. Parkour is male running through industrial areas, correct?
No, I don't do any stunts on these roofs. I try and keep it as safe as possible. Even though, mind you, I am on this, in this photo, I'm about 48 stories up, and I'm sitting like right on the edge. I don't like to play around, because if I slip and fall and I get a bit of water under my shoe, and that siding is just all metal, right? Like I'm just gonna fucking fly right off that roof, and then I'm gonna splatter and. Yeah.
My goodness. All right, I'm pulling up another shot. This is beautiful, this shot. This is a trio of, or four skyscrapers in the background. This is just beautiful photography work, but you must have been at a pretty extreme position to capture this. It should come up, like I said, there's about a 20-second delay on this. Let me know.
Is it another dangle, as they call it? We call it in the industry.
No, I call it dangle shot. No, I don't see you dangling. It's just the.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So this is on Delta Chelsea Hotel. I've been on in hotels. This is one of my favorite roofs in the city. By the way, all these shots are, most of them that I take whenever I do street stuff, it's in Toronto, which is in Canada.
Yeah, this is, like I said, I'm just mesmerized by the photo. It's really something. Obviously, you're in a pretty extreme position to capture this.
Yeah, I'm on the ledge of like where that, you see the little red light in the background. I'm on that same ledge of as where that that light is. But now, ledge is it's pretty wide, honestly.
Yeah, but now I understand the perspective. Now, okay, I got it now, because you're on that ledge. Are you straddling it, or are you?
No, I'm just sitting on the middle of it with my legs dangling on one side, and the other side I'm dangling my other leg. So like I'm pretty safe. And it wasn't windy that night. I remember that night pretty vividly, but I remember it like that. I sat on that building. Yeah, just because I love that building.
Yeah, wind is definitely a factor. Yeah, I would. You know, is a factor in this scenario. All right, I just queued up the next one.
If it's windy on the ground, it's probably, I want to say, 2 to 3 times windier up on the building, depending on how tall it is. There is some buildings where there's no wind at all on one side of it, and then you go on the other side because the wind just pushes up the whole vertical side of the building, and it creates wind. Because it's hitting the glass and then it's going up.
Right. And then I can make the bad joke that if you go on the side where there's wind, technically you're getting blown up there.
Exactly. I'm getting a blowjob.
Yeah, there you go. Absolutely. The same way we do when we clean our computer equipment. I just queued up another one. It's a dangle shot. Wow. That's just amazing.
Yeah.
Okay, tell us a little bit of backstory on this one.
This is the same building as the first one that you first showed with the CN Tower in the background.
Right.
Again, I don't condone anybody to be sitting on these ledges just because you don't know what you're doing when you're on these places. I mean, it might be 2 stories. It might be 5,000 stories. It doesn't matter. If you fall from 10 feet, you will, or not 10 feet. If you fall from 3 stories, you will die almost.
Wait a second. Three stories.
Three stories. About 3 stories. You won't die, but like, I mean, you'll get severely hurt because the human body is not meant to fall like that, right?
Right.
You fall on your leg and you break it, and then it just spews out a bunch of blood out of your leg. You're gonna lose all your blood. Like, you can die from falling just even 3 or 4 stories.
Yeah, well, I'm on, you know, on beach side, I'm on the third floor. On studio side, I'm on the fourth floor. And I always like said, well, gee, what happens if there was a major fire and I couldn't get at the fire escape, you know? Well, I guess I could kind of climb down the balcony. It would be kind of tough, but yeah. So probably live, but get messed up pretty bad from the third story jump, but the fourth story jump up, potentially death. Okay.
Yeah.
Just good to know. I'm
glad.
Potentially. Good for sharing. Sharing that knowledge. I'm going to go ahead and queue up next shot. Let's see.
I think there's like, I left one where it was like, just like on the street.
Yeah, it's a blur shot. This is really, what was the exposure on this? Well, it could take a couple of seconds for the audience to pull it up.
That was, I think that was like maybe like 0.6 of a second, or like 1/6 of a second long exposure handheld.
Gotcha. Yeah, that's great. Listen, I mean, are you continuing with your photography on a daily, weekly basis? I mean, not these necessarily the extreme shots, but are you, you know, is the photography just part of your, you know, hobby now as a regular regular thing?
Yeah, usually now, just because like I'm like I said earlier, venturing out into shooting boudoir-y stuff. I usually take a break every 2 weeks. So like I'll go hard every 2 weeks, like for like 4 or 5 days. And then I'll just not shoot for like a solid week and a half, 2 weeks.
Right.
And then I'll go back out again and I'll shoot with a bunch of girls. And I'll still do rooftops and stuff in the meantime. And some days I'm up almost 24 hours from when I start to like when I finish.
Right. Well, listen, I think you got a great, you know, second career going with this, Tanner. I'm glad you're safe and you logged in everything that you did and no incidents. That's phenomenal. But like I said, your photography was brilliant. Yeah, really very, very impressed. And you know, if there's any links that you want to share with the viewing audience, you know, definitely, you know, type it into the chat room. And I'm going to try, like I said, we're putting this webcast back on the Thursday night at 9 schedule. You know, so hopefully you'll come back in again and share more stuff. You doing anything on the tech side? How is your computer?
That was my computer?
Yeah. What are you using these days? And review tech. I will talk about the mic. Go ahead.
I'm using a 15-inch MacBook Pro. Sorry.
Are you still on the Mac cam? All right, good. Yeah, good.
I've got Apple tattoos on me, like the logo, the old 6-color logo. I've got an Apple desktop bus logo. So like, I'm fully like in the Apple scene.
All right. So next time you have some time for us, you're gonna have to send some pictures of the Apple related tattoos. I think that would be kind of fun to share too.
Yeah, I can do that for sure. I can do that.
Excellent. All right, Tanner, listen, I appreciate you calling in and sharing your photography. I mean, it's phenomenal. It's phenomenal, and I'm glad you're doing well. And as Tanner said, you know, don't let this inspire you to go on top of a building and take a freaking iPhone picture. Don't do it. You know, just don't do it.
No, because there's the building I got caught. The guy said, "Oh, you're the guys that take the selfies on the roofs, eh?" I was like, "No, like we're not taking selfies, dude. We're like, this is way more than just a selfie from your fucking phone."
Yeah, don't insult me. Don't insult me. I'm taking selfies.
Exactly.
Come
like,
on.
I have like a 24 megapixel full frame sensor, and you have this little tiny little plastic lens that's taking pictures.
Good. That was a good retort. Very good. All right, Tanner, listen, enjoy the rest of your evening. And thanks again for doing the call in and sharing your phenomenal photography work with myself and the viewers. Thank you so much.
Yeah, and I'll just leave my Instagram up if anybody wants to go and see it. They're more than welcome to. If you want to follow, you don't have to. If you want to, you can. If you don't want to, you're welcome to. Like I say, though, I am in the loosely boudoir scene. So if you don't appreciate that stuff, by all means, don't look at it. But if you're wanting to see my other stuff that I usually do, I still post that too.
No, awesome. Yeah, like I said, share the link and they'll poke around. I appreciate it, Tanner. Thank you so much.
Yeah, no problem.
Take care. Bye bye.
All right, you too. Bye bye.
Tanner from Canada. Wow, come on, those photos were amazing. I tell you, you know, looking at the photos, I was getting like an anxiety attack. I'm serious. I'm serial. Was that from South Park? I think, right? I'm just closing out these windows. I really need like a second monitor on this setup, make it easier. That and LASIK surgery, so my eyesight is better. Yeah. So good stuff. with Tana. Just amazing. Yeah, Aaron said, wow, 2015-inch laptop. and Review Tech USA, you were asking about the microphone is a Rode, R-O-D-E, broadcaster mic, and it's going in analog to an Aphex channel, and the Aphex channel gives me the limiting and the compressing and the noise gating, and then that broadcaster type of sound quality, those extra harmonics and whatnot, and that allows me to do this, which I know you love. Welcome to station WFCK. The only thing missing is you. Official call sign, FCK. And then from the Aphex channel, it's going digitally into the MOTU, Mark of the Unicorn, MOTU. What the hell is this freaking thing? I don't know. I'm looking. It's the MOTU Ultralight AVB. MOTU Ultralight AVB interface, which is going USB into the Thunderbolt display, which is tethered via Thunderbolt, obviously, to the Mac Pro 6.1 trash can 12 core whore. So that's the setup. And he says, glad to see you making content again. No, you're welcome. No, there's going to be a lot more videos in the queue. So the spell. All right. So the Rode microphone is R-O-D-E. The Aphex channel and MOTU. But you might not want the ultralight AVB. That's audio over Ethernet, which I'm not using. I'm just using it as USB. But I'm going to give you the name of the sales rep at Sweetwater that I use. And you can tell him that you know Alfred and that you want the Alfred.tv discount. But he might charge you 10% more. Brendan. All right. So Brendan's work phone number at Sweetwater Music. I assume you're in the U.S. I'm going to give you his phone number and his extension. But you can give him a call. If he can save you a couple of shekels on shipping or whatever, just tell him, Alfred sent me to you from Alfred.tv. He told me to request the Alfred.tv discount. But Brendan's a good guy. But also tell him what you're trying to do and what your budget is. I mean, you know, this shit was a lot of money. No limits on my end to give the viewing audience the very best, okay? I don't know, this mic was like $400-$600. That Aphex thing was like $1,000. The interface was like another $600, something like that. The trash can, forget it, whatever. Yeah, so there you go. But it's good stuff. It's good stuff. It sounds real good. And there's a fair amount of ambient noise here. But, I have that gate thing gated up, but definitely quieter than running the old 12-core Mac Pro 5.1, which still works and is still used. Anyway, we're going to try calling Ed Diaz. Ed Diaz, formerly from Roland, and he's at NAMM. He's out there in Las Vegas, either, losing money or hitting a buffet or both. I mean, I would promote both activities. And let's see. Oh, yeah, what's his Instagram? Tanner, he didn't post it? Shit. Yeah, we'll have to hit Tanner again for his Instagram, because we do want to see that. He might not have been in the chat. Remember, he's at work, but he's one of the core viewers for like a million years. If we don't catch him now, I should have. I don't know how I'm gonna look it up. I'm going to send him an email. Hang on a second. I'll send Tanner a quick email and ask him. Tanner, what's your IG? The viewers want to know. All right. So I'll see if he gets that on his phone or whatever. And then I'll copy and paste it in. All right, let me see if I can get Ed on the phone. I don't know if he's going to pick up. All right, it's because I said the man's out there working and partying, and it's Vegas, or as I say, vague, V-A-G-U-E space A-S-S, vague ass. So let me see if I can give him a call. I'll call Ed. Let me see if I can schedule Wozniak on a future show as well. That would be fun. All right, let's see if we can get Ed on the phone. Copy, paste. All right. Let's call Ed. Oh, Aaron, you're part of the Ustream crowd. Yeah. No, the Ustream, we had a lot of fun. We're going to have more fun here, too. It's all good. Let's see if he picks up.
Hello?
Mr. Ed Diaz.
Hey.
It's Alfred.
How's it going, man?
It's going well. Hang on. Let me just... I just want to pull up the mixing console so I can make sure you're give me a 1, 2, 3 testy.
Hey, test 1, 2 test. Hey, Diaz testing 1, 2.
All right. I did tell the viewing audience that you're out there either at a buffet or at a gambling table or doing both, which is what I would recommend, and that you are live out there at NAMM. Did the show end for the day, or are you still on the floor?
No, the show is in. We're waiting to get seated at Outback Steakhouse. So, yeah.
I'm here
with Scott Ferry and some of the other guys, yeah.
All right, so you're on. So Ed, listen, certainly don't want to interrupt you with friends and your meal, but can you give us a 2-minute on what, you know, some of the highlights from the NAMM Music Conference?
Am I on the air now?
You are on the air. Oh, absolutely.
Oh, cool. Hey, everybody. Today at the NAMM show, you know, I was kind of checking out the Yamaha booth first off, and checking out the YC61. It's a great kind of combo, kind of organ thing with good piano sounds, electric pianos, of course, organs, and a surprisingly really killer acoustic guitar sound, which I was really surprised to see. You know, I don't know the price yet, but it was, I think it weighs about 16 pounds. It's pretty cool. So, checking out that over at Yamaha, and then I focused on the North Halls over here at NAMM. And, you know, I was checking out the IK Multimedia organ, the BX. So it's pretty cool. So I was checking out that, saw the demo, got the video, and I'll be posting some of those videos on my YouTube channel at Edius Keys on YouTube. Also, this morning I started off the day working with Michelle Moog and got a real nice interview with her, talking about her foundation, her museum, and all the educational plans she has for that. So that was a real nice conversation. I'll hurry up and edit and get that up there for you.
Oh, good. Ed, Ed, you recorded the dialogue with Michelle Moog. That's awesome.
Yeah, yeah. So I tried to record a lot, you know, because obviously I'm changing my course. So, I recorded a lot of this stuff. I recorded a presentation of the Yamaha, which I'm going to get recorded, edited and cleared up soon. And I recorded some different things over at the A Hall, but most of those were more keyboard kind of auxiliary things.
Nothing really
keyboard oriented. Tomorrow I'm going to be at the A Hall, where I'll go to Roland and Korg and Casio and all the other big players. And so I'll be pretty busy doing that. So the way I'm aiming at all these manufacturers is from the point of a keyboard guy or a gigging guy. So that's what we're going to kind of talking about there.
See, now, Ed, you have to be not like me, in which case you're going to record all this wonderful footage, and then, like for me, it takes me 9 years before I post it. I assume you're going to be busy posting right away. So,
yes, that's actually correct. So after dinner, you know, grab up my bros here, and then I'll probably stay up and start editing immediately, you know, so super, super fast. You know, I'll be able to go fast because I'm only using one camera, so that'll help. I'll just make sure the levels are good, quick coloring, and then just throw some titles on, throw my watermark, and we're good to go, you know. So NAMM, it's not going to be the normal videos that I produce, which is a lot more gloss to them. It's going to be more down and dirty, but they're still going to look nice. You know, I'm using a really killer camera with a lens and audio, so should be pretty good. You know, I'm really excited to see what we get, but I know it's only going to get better.
Hey, listen, so, that little teaser clip that you put up where you said, hey, you know, what do you guys want to see? I mean, you look great, you know?
Oh, yeah, thank you. Yeah, so that was a real quick one. You know, I was just testing out the camera to see how the things look there and a little bit of coloring. But, you know, I'm walking around with the Zoom H6 to record the audio. I got a Rode, a video mic Pro on top of my camera using a Canon EOS R with a 24-70 L lens 2.8. And so, you know, I'm trying to use really killer stuff, and it's going pretty good. I also got a couple of lavalier mics, so that way when the presenters are doing their thing, I can go ahead and isolate the keyboard volume from their vocal volume and hopefully take down the noise floor of the NAMM show so we can get a better recording. So today was kind of a rough run through, and tomorrow I'll make my adjustments so that way when I'm recording the guys and then girls presenting, we get a good representation.
All right, Ed, next year I'm going to that show with you, and I assume that you're going to hopefully make the Sweetwater Gear Fest because I'm going to that as well.
Absolutely. I'm going to try. My wife and I are discussing all this. The way that I'm going to make this happen is working with manufacturers. I'll be continuing to do how-to videos like I did with Roland, but we're going to expand to the other brands, and that's going to be on Edius Keys on YouTube, Edius Keys. And if everything goes as planned, we'll go to Sweetwater and cover that. And we're hoping the next year actually cover them better. So, you know, we might need some extra help. So I might bring in some extra people to help and maybe see if we can expand the Edius Keys brand and the channel to cover more gear-oriented stuff for keyboard players as a keyboard guy. So you never know. You know, you might be help me out, and we'll be working together and do some collaborations for our different channels.
Absolutely. And I mean, definitely I can add bad jokes, you know, so.
Oh, I love it.
We'll do it, folks. I don't want to keep you. Listen, enjoy your meal. If Susan's out there, tell her I send my warm regards and your colleagues. And so you'll be able to find Ed on YouTube just search for Ed Diaz, D-I-A-Z, Keys, K-E-Y-S. Is that correct?
That's correct. Yes, sir. Ed Diaz Keys at YouTube. Yes, sir.
There you go. All right, Ed, listen, enjoy the rest of your evening and have some fun and win some money out there, too.
All right. Take care, Alfred. I'll talk to you soon.
Thanks, Ed. Thanks for picking up. Take care. Bye-bye. Bye. We have the great Ed Diaz. So, yeah, so check it out. Oh, and Tanner did respond. Okay, so Tanner's Instagram.
And back in my days, an Instagram was a quick bump of cocaine.
There you go. Back in my days. All right, so he's at Instagram. I'm just going to paste it because I can't. Can make the font bigger on this thing. What is it? I put on my reading glasses. Yeah. All right. So Tanner is at instagram.com/ramj.et. So like ramjet, but there's a period. R is in Richard, A is in Apple, is in Mary, J is in Jane.et. And then on Ed is Ed D-I-A-A-Z-K-E-K-E-Y-S. Ed Diaz Keys. So find him, sub to him on YouTube. I was watching some YouTube last night and Ed popped up on my TV, my television. And he did a little video that said, you know, let me know what you want to see. And I'm like, Ed, we want to see all the weird stuff. Show us weird blippy things and make weird noises. You know, it's all good. But yeah, so 10:40, 43. All good. Let me check this fine chat room. So did you all get his Instagram? I posted that and then Ed Diaz Keys. Let's type it properly. www.youtube.com/EdDiazKeys. Give Ed a sub and a thumbs up, and this is a new launch for him. Good guy, and what a phenomenal, he does really phenomenal videos, and he plays so beautifully. There's some stuff on my YouTube channel where I recorded Ed, I think he was playing the Roland Jupiter 80. So good. So Tanner said, I was on my period when I had the thought for the IG name. Well, good. All right, and Vince DiAurea. Vince, this is a stock question that I always ask Vince. back a gazillion years ago when we were doing this crap. And let's face it, it's still crap. On Ustream. Vince, what color is your hair? Because Vince had like the coolest hair colors. It was green one week and purple the other week. And then a mix of different colors. And he actually pulled it off. It looked pretty good. The wacko color hair. I like it. I may turn my gray into a little bit of purple. I like purple. Dark royal. Nice. Okay, so what else do I got up my sleeve? Let's see. Boys, this is really enjoying. I hope you're enjoying the callers tonight. You guys have been great. Thank you so much for calling in, and thank you to the viewers for tuning in. Okay, this is kind of interesting. I'm going to go to the desktop. Let me just pull up this photo. I'm going to go on a different tangent now and talk about some things on the computer geeky side. All right, hang on. I'm pulling up a photo. Switching to desktop. Let me see if I can pull it up. Where the hell is it? Preview. Should be that. Okay. So there you go. All right. So my friend Lana gave me a call today. And she took a picture of her screen with her iPhone and showed me this. And of course, the first thing, I know that Microsoft is pumping out NAG screens now. Listen, I don't know if any of you all are still running 7. I mean, there's a shit ton of people that are still running Windows 7. Hell yeah, I was running XP for like the longest time, as you know. But let me ask you, have any of you seen that NAG screen? Your Windows 7 PC is out of support. Because Microsoft, like I said, with one of their latest updates, they pushed out that NAG screen, which is unbelievable. Hang on, I just got to send a quick note. I'm just asking what the election results are. Yes, Aaron, you're correct. Yeah, he was the guy that doing the Roland demos. He was with Roland for a long time. But that's a legit Windows. That's legit from Microsoft. That one. Yeah, no, listen, I was still running XP for a gazillion years. I have friends that use Media Center on Windows 7. But one of the problems now with this type of prompt being pushed by Microsoft is that the scammers that are calling people, I mean, they can really go over pretty well. Oh yeah, this is Microsoft. Yeah, you're out of compliancy and all this other crap. So I'm a little bit like worried about people that are getting these NAG screens from Microsoft and then they're getting those scam calls. It's going to be a real mess. Now, I don't know if any of you have watched. I'm sure some of you have watched my crappy iPhone 11 unboxing video, which I filmed with one of my local friends, Aziz. And at the tail end of the iPhone 11 unboxing video, I get a phone call from a scammer, and we kind of mess around with him. So I'm gonna switch to the desktop. I'm gonna pull up the clip. It has a 5-minute runtime. I'm gonna take a quick break. But if you haven't, and it's at the end of the iPhone 11 video, so it's only like the real core viewers that are watching my crap. I'm going to split it off to a separate video, though, because I think it can help people. Wozniak commented on the video, and he got a real kick out of it as well. And he had text messaged me like, now I know how to handle these scammers, And the bottom line, I'll tell you, yeah, Z-Hawk, what I'll tell you before you watch the clip is that, and Adam helped clarify this, when they're making those robocalls and you hit 1 to accept the call and connect, okay, if I hang up, the scammer on the other end is off the hook. Hey, I wasn't able to, get any gift cards from them. They hung up. But to make them hang up, I think they kind of get a little bit of a demerit. In other words, he tells me, hang up the call, man. He was pissed. But I think you get a kick out of how we handled it. And of course, the real gold here is that my friend Aziz is from Bangladesh. He's one of them there Bangla boys. He's from Bangladesh. But Aziz is fluent in four languages, English, Hindi, and two others. So when he heard the guy on the call center like mutter something in Hindi, you know, Aziz came back in Hindi saying, you know, hey, you know, what's up? So I'm going to cue up the clip. And I think you'll enjoy this. If you haven't seen it, you're going to enjoy this. If you have seen it, it still runs pretty good, even as a second time. So let's see. Where is that damn clip? He took our jabs. Fun video clips. And right, here's a scammer call with Aziz. Let me just get this window positioned. We'll go to the desktop. And that's okay. All right, let's just get this position right. Okay, I'm going to run this clip. I hope you enjoy it. So here's the tail end of my iPhone 11 unboxing video with my good friend Aziz, one of my locals. And I take a call from a scammer. Here we go.
Apple device, please contact Apple Support Advisor. Press 1 to connect with Apple Support Advisor.
This is beautiful.
Press 2 to listen to this message again.
Hello?
Thank you for the support. How can I help you today?
Hello? I have a call about my iCloud or something? I don't know.
Yes, sir. That the call you have received was an automatic call from the Apple server, alright?
Which Apple server?
Apple support, not Apple service.
Oh, how can I help you?
So, we are receiving a notification with your iCloud account has been logged on in many overseas countries like Turkey, Japan and Russia. So we just wanted to verify that are you the one who's traveling in overseas country?
Yeah, I'm in Russia now.
Not Russia, Turkey, Japan and...
Where?
Turkey and Japan.
That was my prior visit. I was there last week, so those are okay.
That was you?
Yeah.
How can you travel in one time in two countries?
I'm sorry, say again?
How can you travel one time in two countries?
Why, I travel all over the world.
So within the last 24 hours?
Say again?
Within the last 24 hours?
Yes. Yeah, no, I have a private jet.
Hello?
Yeah, no, I have a private jet, so I bounce around. I work for the government.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Abe, kya hua?
Private jet?
Abe, kya hua?
Kya hua?
Kya hua, yeah. You were speaking Hindi. Come on now. Let's go.
Us private jet ko apni gaand mein le le. Listen. Understood.
Yeah, yeah. Where are you calling from?
Where are you calling from?
Yeah, yeah, I know. Where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Cupertino, California.
That accent doesn't look like from California, man. Sounds like you're calling from India.
Alexander, do one thing. Record his call right now.
Sure. We are also recording too.
Alright, now I will make your phone report and
sure.
I will send to my Apple server.
Yeah, please do that.
Then they will block your
all
accounts.
Do you need my Apple ID?
Wait, no, maybe you didn't. No, give him the bank routing number.
Yeah, do you need my bank routing
How
number?
How about a bank routing number?
Yes.
You want my credit card? Give me the Amex Platinum. No, give me the Amex Black card. That's a good one. We'll, you know, Because I have like $100,000 minimum a month I got to spend on that. Maybe this guy can use it.
Yeah.
No, I don't know. This doesn't sound
like it. Yeah, it's all right. Now I'm transferring my call to my senior department.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead, please.
Yeah,
thank
please,
you.
Thank you. Oh, my God.
Yeah, hello?
Yes.
Yeah, so what happened, sir?
Nothing
I'm
happened.
Apologizing from my junior technician.
Why do you
regarding your iCloud account verification, sir? Okay.
Okay. Why the first of all, why do you sound the same?
Sir, the thing is that your account has been compromised with some unauthorized users.
Okay.
So they're hacking your network, sir.
Wait. They're hacking my network or my Apple ID.
Yeah.
They're hacking my corporate network. They're hacking my network.
Yes, sir.
I work for the NS fucking A. I don't think they're hacking my network.
I like your smile, sir.
Oh, God. We're going to do a call trace back on this guy.
Yeah, and find out where the source is coming from.
Yeah, this is pretty funny.
Or just nuke him.
I have to get Waz on the phone. He's going to love this one. Hello?
Listen.
I'm listening.
Is something funny? Is this something funny?
Yeah, talk to me, man.
Hang up the call, man.
No, you called us, you're gonna hang up. Go ahead.
Otherwise, you will listen something new words.
Okay.
Oh, don't worry.
Good.
Go ahead.
Let's hear.
If I say two new words, you will be blind from your ears.
I'll be blind from my ears. Go ahead. No, the audience is going to love this. Ah! Ah, he fucking hung up.
What a fail.
Listen.
Oh.
Wait, we're getting a frame on this one. You couldn't have...
Oh,
let focus. You couldn't have planned that any better. A scam call just as I activated the new phone and we made them hang up. Fuck you.
Exactly. And there was that thing, they can speak Hindi in front of me.
Yeah. No.
They don't know that I also speak Hindi fluently.
He speaks four languages and no problem. But that was funny, isn't
that
it?
Was
I'm so glad I took the call. I didn't know who the hell it was. But anyway, so now this is actually like a pretty good iPhone
and
video for the people that stick through the video. All right. So, yeah. More to come. Stay tuned. Maybe they'll call back. Let's give them a call.
We'll see. Now, that is hilarious.
So there you have it. I mean, like I said, you couldn't have scripted that one any better. And I will... I would assume you would agree. I'm going to post it as a standalone video. And I think people will enjoy that. And maybe it might, you know, educate a few people for what to listen to. And, you know, listen, if you have the time, you can have fun with those people. I started watching quite a few YouTube videos of people that were baiting the scammers and connecting to their systems and wiping out their files. I mean, just really pretty damn funny. Good stuff. I had a question, though, for my tech centric people that are watching. I'm just closing out a couple of windows here. You know, one of the things that I found confusing, and first of all, does anyone know any of those big tech people that are scamming the scammers? Because if someone knows them, I'd like to invite one of them on the show. There was one guy, he puts on a wig, he puts on like, he does vocalization, some digital vocalization. He's like an old lady. I mean, they're really, really well done. Very entertaining. And like I said, I've been watching a few of them. And I think the video that Aziz and I, though, like I said, it was ad hoc and nothing was planned. We didn't have any technology on our end to really do anything, but we just had fun with them logically. Yeah. Turkey, Russia, and Japan. Oh, yeah. Those are all valid. How do you come back from that? You know? Melon Hipster says, Barnacles had the best ones since used to work for Microsoft. Oh, that's fine. Oh, yeah. Jim Browning is one fellow that I watched. I wonder if I can invite one or two of those fellas on. I think that would be fun. But and I know my audience is very, very tech-centric. I've seen it where they let the scammer come into their PC, and usually it's a virtualized PC, so it's sandboxed. They let the scammer come into their PC. They give them the log me in or whatever, team viewer codes. But then I see them deleting the scammer's files. So what? If the scammer is logged in to your PC and you run an FTP client, all their stuff shows up? How did they kind of flip it around? I don't understand how they flipped around the control. Kit Boga is the one who does the voices and way. Yeah, he's hysterical. Listen, with Kit Boga, if you even take away the whole scenario of the scam, he's funny. Like his on-the-spot comedy, very impressive. I really liked him. Very good. Very good. Cyber Detective says you could tell he pulled that threat from his ass. Yeah. Yeah, I tell you, I'm so glad I took that call. It really was fun. But I get the calls all the time to my cell. I'm going to start recording them. I mean, I'll just fuck around with them, you know. But Shiggity says, no, the remote access client has... Oh, all right. So in other words, if I let them connect to me, to a virtualized machine that I'll sandbox in VMware Fusion or whatever... once they connect to me, I can then pull up a file transfer and just wreak havoc. But if they're connected to me and he pulls up file transfer, aren't they going to see the screen? Aren't they going to see the file transfer window? And Kyle says, a few years ago, I got a call saying my Windows computer had been hacked. Ended up wasting about an hour of their time. Let them into a Linux VM, and the dude was incredibly confused. Yeah. Scott says, send the tachyon pulse back along the tractor beam. it has to be you, Mr. Mugen. So a wave and a shout out. Hello. That's funny. you can disable input, and usually they can't. You know, I also saw several times a reference to Syskey, which, if I understand correctly, it's kind of like an old, outdated tool or encryption tool. So is that Syskey functionality in Windows 10? Can you go to the command line and do Syskey and start locking things up? Or did they yank it out with 7 or 8? Aaron says, make a honeypot and have some juicy viruses load up. Yes. I mean, Aaron, do you have viruses in your inventory? Because I'm going to maybe tap you for some. We're going to load up that VM machine. Absolutely. You know, and good to see you, Scott. Scott is one of the people that runs the NatMac meeting that I go to once a month. It's the first Wednesday of the month. And I don't know, Scott, can we live stream it? You think Dean would allow us to live stream it? I mean, or maybe we just live stream the back row so they can hear the jokes from me, you, Adam, Mo. That would be funny. So Gasper, you're saying Syskey is still active? Oh, Microsoft pulled it in 10. Okay. But listen, I still have lots of XP around. I'm sure we could load up an XP machine with a lot of toxic stuff. That would be fun. That would be fun. But I was really laughing my ass off when one of the scammers flagged one of the scam baiters' video. I think it was Mr. Browning. Like, they wanted their privacy. They didn't want their content exposed. I thought that was pretty funny. Pretty ballsy. Scott says, a slowly dying user group. No, Scott. We got to amp it up. We got to get some young blood in there and broaden up the topic base. And we have to help Mr. Dean at the front. We just can't let him. It's not fair. The man just monologues for 2.5-3 hours. Adam and I and you have to get up front and contribute. I think it's great. I really enjoy going to the meetings. It's good seeing everyone, and it's kind of fun. Aaron says, but yeah, have a Windows VM and wreak havoc with the file transfer. Yeah, that's good. OS 2 VM. Okay. Kyle says, in one video I saw, this dude wiresharked their network. I'm not sure what Wireshark means, so explain. Wireshark, the network IPs and credentials, ended up wiping every computer on the network. Wow. Wow, that's something. And Kaltash says, I thought Siski became Shitlocker? I mean, Bitlocker. Okay. Yeah. Fun. I tell you, like I said, I have to assume that those scammers, they really got to think twice on who and what is on the other end. But hey, you know, I guess in one sense, it serves a little bit of a function. Those big YouTubers that do this stuff, they get a lot of content. And make it OS. OS2 Warp was actually pretty damn good back in the day. Oh, speaking of back in the day. Hang on. I'm going to pull something else out of my asshole. All right, you're going to love this. And this is something I plan to really expand upon. All right, let's go. We're going to go to the hover cam. All right, you're seeing absolutely nothing except the part of an envelope. And let's clear that desk. Nice and clear. Okay. So just for people who might not have seen it, you know, I as the precursor to the segment with Michael Panzerotto, you know, I did pull out of my asshole, it really hurt, my Lost in Space lunchbox from 1967 when I was in it was either kindergarten or first grade. But that is my actual lunchbox. I have a problem throwing things out. So hopefully you're seeing something on here. Hang on a second. Yeah, there we go. All right, you got it. I got to remember that there's that 20-second delay. And let's just flip it to the other side so you can see the graphic on the back. And there are some side graphics as well. But yeah, this is like some retro shit. And that's based on the original Lost in Space. Yeah, funky. Yeah, it's a funky green color. Yeah, it is. And it's old. So it's probably a little oxidized. And Kyle says, unfortunately, I had an elderly family member fall for a tech support scam. They ended up stealing about $500. Yeah, I had a few people fall for it as well. Scott says, I have my Star Wars lunchbox. Let's look at the sides. So there's the side creature from, like, I think the episode was They Might Be Giants or something like that. Also sounds like a bad They May Be Giants. And the boys shooting the laser at it. And let's see the other graphic. Oh, come on, that jetpack. The jetpack was just so damn cool. You know, the way they filmed that. And it looks so great. I mean, I think they were dangling him from like a helicopter or whatever. But some great freaking aliens. Yeah, good shit. So yeah, so the Lost in Space lunchbox, but let's go forward in time from 1966. Let's go to 1980 now. Look at this. Let's get in there. I guess I'm gonna have to, you know, work on getting this camera positioned a little bit higher. But now we're looking at, remember, I was selling computers. We didn't call them PCs back in the day. We called it microcomputers. And the computers were delineated by the bit of the CPU. You know, 8-bit were microcomputers, 16-bit were mini computers, and mainframes, 32 bits in the CPU architecture. So I was selling and involved with the microcomputer industry, as we called it back then, since 1978. And while I threw out a lot of stuff, Scott says I have every issue as a PDF. Nice, Scott. That's beautiful. While I did throw out a lot of stuff, I did save a lot of stuff as well. And I thought what would be fun, and you tell me if you agree, is breaking out some of these old magazines and like flipping through them and like filming it as a YouTube video. Obviously, I'm doing quick and dirty with the hover cam to give it to you live now. I'd have to get it a little bit higher so we can see the full publication. And I have another overhead scanner that's even better than this. But I thought that, yeah, two dancing meatballs. So this is Creative Computing from 1980. I mean, let's look at a couple of ads though. Okay. Low cost hard disk computers are here and field proven. Look at this freaking thing. Holy shit. I mean, this is from Chromemco. All right. This is from Chromemco. NorCal says they look like two poop emojis. Here we go. Wow, back in the day. Look at the S100 bus cards. And oh no, actually that was Mountain Computer. Well, Mountain Hardware. Right. This was a digital speech system for the Apple II from a company called Mountain Hardware. They changed their name to Mountain Computer because people, they were like a hardware company and were calling up, you know. But yeah, that gave digitized speech in an Apple II back in freaking 79, 1980. Oh, come on, look at the graphics. Look at the resolution. Oh, shit. Oh, man, listen. You guys have no idea how good y'all have it. Oh, I tell you, this is a great trivia question. This is a great trivia question. One of the best-selling products for the Apple II was the Microsoft Z80 soft card, which put the Z80, the Zilog Z80 microprocessor, 8-bit processor, into your Apple II. And then you can run another operating system and run CPM, which was like a precursor to DOS. And you were able to load in and access tons of shareware software. I mean, it was just effing unbelievable. I think I still have a working Z80 card. Scott, you probably have one, you know? Yeah, would you like to play a game? But there it is. And one of the best-selling products for the Apple II back in the day. And it was expensive. It was like, I think this thing was like $200 in 1977, $1978 dollars. So just thumbing through a few. I'm just randomly picking some pages. The hell is this? Oh yeah, okay, here you go. Printing. Look at, listen. We had dot matrix printer, you know, the printer that went you know, matrix printing. But if you were a real baller, you had a daisy wheel printer hooked up to your Apple II. And this thing was amazing. The company was Diablo. And you had this daisy wheel, this wheel that had different fonts, and it was an impact hammer. Bang! It hit the character, and it gave real print on a printer. And it was loud as hell, but the printout was beautiful. It was like an automated typewriter, you know, these things were like a couple of grand back in the day, you know. But yeah, daisy wheel printer. Yeah, listen, that was printed on an Apple II, I think on Apple's thermal printer. So that's what grainy ass shit looked like back then, you know. So we're going through. Oh, this was an interesting program. Scott, do you remember this program? What's up, Lame Llama? And Al Cologne says, I used to sell those for $190 when I was in college. What, the Z80 cards? Yeah, they were like $200. They were good. But Scott, do you remember this program called WatsIt? WatsIt was like a freeform database. And I remember one of my customers from like 79 or 90, yeah, it was like 1979. He wanted to get WatsIt and like put like everything he knew, his brain, into this app. So when he passed on, you know, his family would have just all types of data of his thoughts. He was trying to, you know, put himself into an Apple II. It wouldn't work on 8-bits. But WatsIt was an interesting freeform database. We see the Apple a little differently. Who is this? What company? California Computer Systems. I don't know what the hell they were selling back then. Just thumbing through. Oh yeah, this printer was a major breakthrough. I sold a lot of these. The Paper Tiger. This was a dot matrix printer, but this dot matrix printer was able to output some pretty damn amazing dot matrix graphics. I mean, look at this tiger that it printed out. I mean, it was really amazing, really amazing. It has some really great features, and it was a fun printer. Yeah, kind of cool to have this issue. The hell is this? Oh, wow, yeah. The advertising, yes, sensational software, like that text-based adventure game. This is like, you know, we were wowing back in the day before we had, you know, graphics. Blah, 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 blah. I'm trying to see if there's any nice colored ads. And this actually, this article, one of the reasons why I saved this magazine was they were talking about digitizing audio. You know, and just what forward thinking, you know, how audio gets digitized into a computer and the concept of, you know, maybe one day, you know, we can, you know, we'll have all our music digitized. Whoop-de-doo. I'm just thumbing through really quick. I'm just getting obnoxiously fast now. Okay, so there you go. Look, all right, here you go. Software for the TRS-80, the Trash 80 as we called it. Software. Yeah, look at the graphics. Look at the dog shit that we had back then. Just block, black and white block graphics. Cyber detective says kind of wants to make me find my old 386. Lame Llama says yes, the Z80 was used in the Sega Master System. It was a great chip. The Z80 was a great chip. You know? And yeah, that printer was pretty advanced for the day. Ads, blah, you know, wow, listen. Look, I mean, just look at the depth of the content. You know, we did a lot more reading back then. Not as much pictures. Let's see what we got back there. All right, so I guess some of the back classified ads. TRS-80 level 2. Radio Shack, long gone. Do you see eye to eye with your Apple II? I'm looking at that advert. Anyway, and here's the back. Another company. This was, I think, Ohio Scientific. Just looking at it, they had a pretty interesting system, but you know the keyboard felt like shit. It was a metal piece. I mean, the Apple II just you know. They did it right. And then speaking of Apple II, you know, I just happen to have this, the great Hovercam. One of Wozniak's best inventions from back in the day. There's the controller card for the Apple II that let you plug in disk drive. I mean, there it is. I think this board is actually blown, but it's like a work of art. I kept it because it's like a work of art. Yeah, right. Yeah, Aaron, 16 colors. Ooh, you know. So that's that. And I while I was shoplifting at the supermarket today at Publix, I haven't bought a Mad magazine in like a million years. But they did a Mad magazine with just goofing on Star Wars, you know, so like kind of like this fun stuff. Definitely, you know, check this out. But kind of, you know, kind of fun. It's Star Wars. It's a Star Wars issue. So kind of fun. What's on the back? You know. Come on, hover cam, focus. Focus. Man, whatever. Doesn't having trouble with that one, but yeah, fun issue. And I'm gonna switch back to my mug. And I was asking my friend Derek out in Colorado if he can join in. He's one of my gamer friends. Unfortunately, I was at work, but next time if you do one on a Monday or a Tuesday night, I'll definitely be tuning in. Excellent. Anyway, yeah, would you like to see more of the retro stuff? It looks like that's in vogue right now. People are enjoying all the retro computer stuff. I thought it'd be kind of fun to really dig through some of the magazines and documents. I did find the Apple 1978 Apple price list. And you think that new Mac Pro is expensive. When you look back at a full Apple II system and you convert, you know, do the dollar conversion, you know, adjusting for time and inflation, holy crap, you know. So Let me know if you'd like to see more of the magazines. I think I might do them as formal YouTube videos. But anyway, 20 after 11, I went a little bit later than I had planned, but I'm going to wrap up this live webcast. And everyone's giving me a thumbs up and an oh yeah on that. I hope you enjoyed tonight's streamed webcast. See, now I can use the word stream with webcast. I'm streaming a webcast. Now it makes perfect sense. I wanted to thank again the callers, and I wanted to thank you all for joining me. I'm really going to try to keep this on schedule with Thursday nights, 9 p.m. U.S. Eastern, and to the international crew. I'm going to maybe see if I can slot in at 7:30 or 8 a.m. U.S. Eastern time on Sunday morning, and so I'll have some fun with y'all across the pond or on the other side of the planet. So anyway, that's the wrap, everyone. I want to thank you all for tuning in. This will be posted on YouTube, so for those that missed it, they can watch it in post. And what else can I say but more to come? Stay tuned, and you'll be seeing a few more YouTube videos as well. All right, so that's a wrap, everyone. Enjoy the rest of your night and have a wonderful, fantastic, fun, safe, healthy weekend. More to come. Stay tuned. Throw up the peace sign. Thank you. See you soon.